Hello, everybody, and welcome to our Lyfebulb Live, where we're going to be talking about tips when you have a chronic illness during the holidays. I think this is always a great conversation to have because it is hard to navigate. We want to, you know, give us some solutions and some tricks that we use. Today, we have one of our amazing ambassadors on. Her name is Nathalie. She not only speaks about living with IBD, but being a college student with IBD, having mental health challenges with IBD and being a college student. And we're going to talk about what the holidays are for her and how she navigates them. So thank you so much, Nathalie, for being part of our conversation today.
Welcome, Nathalie. I'm Karin. I'm the CEO of Lyfebulb. I'm happy to be here with Annmarie. That's okay. I'm just here. Just hanging out. That's perfectly fine. I'm mostly interested in what Nathalie can tell us and your experiences. I personally know it is tough to go into holidays with family, with or without disease, because you're suddenly with people you love and you can't hurt, but you probably hurt the most of everyone because you know they will still probably love you. So it's a complex, relationship, right? It's the people that you really keep the closest, that know the most about you. And there's all that pressure of being happy and being together and having all that food that affects us, you know, more or less, depending on what our health condition is.
Yeah, I'm so glad, sure. Karin, that you said that whether you have a health condition or not, because that is so important. And I think some of the things we're going to be talking about applies to all of that. It doesn't matter if you have a health condition, you might still have some struggles with family members. So I love that. So Nathalie, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so I'm a college student at Stanford University right now. It's definitely been tough because I've transitioned from being virtual for an entire year and suddenly I'm on campus, like super far away from home. So that's been a challenge in itself. I'm really grateful to have accommodations right now. But yeah, it was totally, and it is totally still weird to suddenly be the only advocate, you know, for my health. Because before, like, I had family support. But, you know, now it's like, oh, I'm sick, I'm chronically ill. Okay, well, I have to get up, I have to go, you know, get my medication, I have to, you know, do all of this. Like, I don't really have anyone to do that for me. And so that transition alone has definitely been tough, but has also shown me, like, just how capable, you know, myself and other people with chronic illnesses are when you're managing all of this on your own. But yeah, I'm really excited to talk about just how my chronic illness affects, like, not only like the way I look at holidays, but also what I consider. And yeah, just some kind of tips to, like, how to deal with some of those concerns that come up around this time of year.
So where are you going for the holiday?
Oh, right now, so I'm at home right now. So with my family, just my immediate family at the moment.
So that's in Texas, or where is it?
Oh, no, California. Yeah.
So Nathalie, you did say something that just made me think, and I didn't even think about it till you were saying it. You're right. You have to go get your medication, make sure you have everything. But you also have to make sure that when you go home, that you have everything that you need when you're traveling home for the holidays. I didn't even think about that as a student. Is that something that you thought about beforehand?
Yeah. No, that's definitely one of the struggles, I think, because so Stanford's up in NorCal and I am originally from SoCal. So I do have to fly back home. And that was one of my considerations, was remembering all my medications that I had to bring. And another thing too is I get my current medications delivered to my house down here, not up in college. So I have to make sure, oh, I'm ordering all my medications to be ready for me here so I can take them back with me. I have to make sure I have enough medication for while I'm here, or extra in case, like, an emergency pops up. And so all of that is actually quite stressful because, like, the day before, like, I really want to make sure I don't forget anything. But, like, of course, I forgot, like, one of my medications. And so that's, like, so incredibly frustrating because it's so easy to forget things when you're, like, managing, like 10 to 15, like, different medications, including your supplements, you know.
So I got to say, I mean, I hear this from everyone who's living with a disease where you have more than one medication. You know, it's just, it's almost it's almost impossible to get it right. And I mean, you're obviously a very intelligent young woman.
Thank you.
I consider myself that. I also know a little bit about healthcare. And I find it so hard to get it right, to get all those drugs in the right places. And the whole system is, I think, flawed. You know, if you can't have a backup at home for, or if you're living in two places or you're traveling, and every time you have to argue with the insurance company that you may be gone more than a certain time period, and you can't get it's too early to get your drugs, or they send it to the wrong place. And, you know, I kind of, and you're too young for this, but I kind of look back at when it used to be that you would go to your pharmacy, you had a written prescription, you got it in your hand, and you walk back home, or you go on your bicycle, whatever you do. I sound ancient, but I mean, it was so much easier. Now everything is automatic and it's auto delivery and all that kind of stuff. And it's just more difficult because all these little steps in the process that is supposed to simplify you, there's a possibility of a mistake. And I think they make a mistake every single month, for me at least. And it actually adds stress. And I'm not crazy bringing it up right now, but it adds stress to a holiday. Going away, I mean, I remember it for summer. You know, if you're going away for a summer vacation and you suddenly don't have your drugs, and what are you going to do? You know, you're going to feel bad. You're going to feel bad that you're missing your drugs, and it potentially could be really damaging. So I to all those insurance companies out there, and PBMs or whatever they're called, and doctors, just make it easy for patients would be a priority, I think, versus adding more technology.
Yeah. Even just giving your pills with a couple extra in there so you can get through a few more days, because sometimes, I mean, I've noticed I've been out of pills and it's a Saturday and it won't get filled again until Sunday because my doctor has to order it. I can't just call in the RX. You know, some of them are, you know, controlled substances that I take. So I have to be on top of that. It's really hard. And I didn't even think about traveling for the holidays with it because I'm usually local. I don't have to do that, but that is another stressor. I like Jackie's little comment here about saving some pill bottles so that you don't have to travel with all of them, because I've actually left some of my medication in like hotel rooms before. So that is a great idea.
Yeah. That's another thing too, with just for like the holidays thing, as for like passing, like, oh my gosh, I have so much anxiety when I go to an airport and like having to go through TSA. I just feel like I have something wrong with my luggage. And so, so I like bring a carry-on with me, and then I get really nervous when I bring my medications because sometimes I don't have the prescription label or the box. Because, like, you know, when you have a chronic illness, for me, when I get a medication I use, I cut it open. I'm like so aggressive with it. I like throw it out, put it in a box, just because it's so casual for me and it's so normal. So I'll forget like little things like that. And so it's incredibly stressful to look for, you know, the prescription label so you can prove like, oh, I'm using this medication. And that's so stressful when you have like so many at once that you're managing, because it's already difficult to adhere to your medication. And I hate that word adhere, as if we're like some kind of like, like little experiment we have to continue using our medication. But it's just incredibly difficult when either like you don't even have them in the first place, or it almost feels like a job. Like I always say like my chronic illness is like a part-time job, because when I'm doing like normal things, I always have to think about things that no one else does. And that it just adds like so much stress. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. I think the other part to the medication is during the holidays, you aren't on a regular schedule. You aren't doing what you do on a regular. Yeah. And remembering to take that medication can sometimes, you know, you forget. Maybe you're cooking, you know, Thanksgiving dinner with your family and it's noon and you were supposed to take it, and all of a sudden it's 2 o'clock and you completely forgot. Yeah. And a lot of medication is time sensitive. Mm-hmm. How do you manage that? How do you make sure that you're taking your medication during the holidays with everything else going on?
Yeah, I'm so glad you brought that up, because that is actually an exact problem I had yesterday. So one of the things, because, you know, I have Crohn's disease, but I also have IBS. So something that's important to me to manage my IBS, because that's something I kind of just deal with more on the daily now that my Crohn's is in remission, is remembering to eat meals frequently and not eat large meals. And this will play really not very nicely with Thanksgiving, is there's kind of this like expectation, like, oh, I'm going to starve myself for the entire day and then eat a giant meal so I can fit everything. And that's just not realistic for someone with IBS. So that was like something, like I forgot to eat like lunch, for example. And then because of that, I felt really sick like the following night. And as for remembering to take my medication, that's also difficult because especially now that, you know, I am physically present in college, like I have like a set schedule and it makes it easier for me to take my meds. So because I don't have that here anymore, something that's been kind of helpful is to like try to simulate like what I usually do on a daily basis at college. So I'll set like little reminders like, oh, maybe I can do a little work, you know, in the morning. That way I feel like I'm like back at school, back in like the schedule I'm used to. And it doesn't feel so like overwhelming that everything has changed.
Yeah. Right. You know, it's funny because comments often, I have the same experience. And for me, I also cannot just starve myself and then eat a big meal. I also don't want to. I mean, it's why do you want to do that?
Yeah.
But then people say, well, don't you want to, there's a Swedish word for it, but I don't even know the English. I'm not sure it even exists, but it's like, won't you allow yourself to do this? But it's a really kind of annoying Swedish word that describes it. But it's like, won't you allow yourself once in a while to do that? I'm like, it's not allowing myself. I'm going to feel worse by doing that. Why would I allow myself to feel worse just because it's your feeling of feeling good? So it's funny how these expectations for a holiday are sometimes really detrimental to someone who has issues related to food that impact your disease. And, you know, you're allowing yourself to feel good is actually requiring a schedule and requiring you to eat in a certain way. So, you know, why is that not? That's actually prioritizing yourself. But it can make you seem really like obsessed with your organization. And then people have the ability to just say, oh, you know, that's or the right to criticize.
I love that you said obsessed with your organization, because that's not what it is. Like if I eat too much, that affects me for days after. I cannot. And I feel absolutely horrible. And I come from a family of huge eaters. You know, Thanksgiving, you know, it's so funny whenever I hear someone talk about Thanksgiving and they say, don't you starve yourself until it just, I've heard it all. Everything that you guys said, or they work out in the morning so they can eat a big meal. My family starts eating at like 10 o'clock in the morning with a breakfast. And then there's appetizers at like 1:00. And then there's a huge meal at 4:00. And then there's dessert at 6:00. And then it all comes back out again at 8:00. And I can't do that. Like I can't. I will be so sick. And it's taken a lot for my family to understand that that is not how I'm going to eat. One thing that I do is I use a smaller plate than everybody else. And I have to do that because it's almost like you're copycatting them sometimes. Like I remember one time I put all this food on my plate and then I had this immense voice in this back of my head that was my Nana saying, eat everything on your plate, everything on your plate. Right. And I did. And I was so utterly sick. I can't do that. So a good trick is to use a smaller plate.
I didn't even think about that, but that's an amazing idea. I think that's something that's also really common in Hispanic culture. I'm Mexican myself. And like ever since you're like basically trained to like always finish your food. And ever since a young age, like I never did, like I just always really ate like in small portions. And then another thing that happens a lot, especially like, in Mexican cultures, they give you like little nicknames. So for me, like they'd always call me like Flaquita, which is just like skinny basically. And so when I got sick, it got even worse because it's like, I really didn't want to eat like large portions, but I would just eat more frequently. So it always seemed like I was eating like less than everyone else, but it's just like, no, I just spread it out so I can handle, you know, it. And that is just like, it's so stressful, you know, because it almost feels like everyone's eyes are on you, you know, because like you're serving like significantly less or maybe like nothing at all. Like there's so many like staples and Thanksgiving dinners that like I can't have like corn, for example. Like that's not really the best idea. And when another interesting thing is because my brother has ulcerative colitis and I have Crohn's. So when my brother he got sick, we made like changes to our diet. And you know, for example, like Thanksgiving, like we had to make two separate mashed potatoes. I remember one with butter and then one without, and it really only had like the tiniest bit of salt and pepper because my brother was so sensitive. to a lot of foods. And then I got diagnosed. So now everything changed except for my parents who didn't really have to, you know, follow that diet. But yeah, you just feel like people are just kind of like watching you like the whole time, like, oh, why isn't she eating more? Like, and especially because, you know, when you're sometimes when you're chronically ill and your illness like presents itself physically, as it has for me, and like I lost like a lot of weight, like people, you know, they'll just, people will call judgments about you and the way you look. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And my family gets offended if you don't eat. That's the other problem. They're really offended if you're not eating.
Yeah.
And that goes up to what Nathalie, what we were saying about how do you handle those uncomfortable comments? How do you have to, how I've learned to do it is I have set tone in my head. I know that my aunt's going to yell at me for not eating, you know, whatever it is. And I have to pre-set a language in my head that I'm going to say to her so that I can just end it and walk away. And that does help me because you don't want to upset anybody, but at the same time, you have to take care of yourself.
Yeah. So yeah, that makes me think of actually, I think that's a really wonderful plan. It's so important to set boundaries with people once they start, you know, if they start like, you know, asking questions that make you uncomfortable. And it's so difficult because like, I was never really taught how to set boundaries. And another thing too, is just like this happens a lot, like in my culture, it's just like, you never really want to call someone out for saying something that made you uncomfortable. And especially as a woman, you're kind of like taught to like keep the peace. So like, you know, keep those internal like feelings to yourself because you don't want to cause like any problems in the family or any drama or anything like that. And, you know, I hate that because it's so important, like you said, like to kind of have like that, like preset, like a response in your head, like, how am I going to say this? And I think something we forget is like, we can just say no to things. Like, it's so easy to want to say yes all the time, but you can just say, no, I don't really want to answer that, and then walk away like it.
Yeah. And I think the point you make, Nathalie, is so good. You don't always have to explain yourself.
Yeah.
You don't have to say, no, I can't have that because. You can just say no. No, thank you. It's actually really, my daughter, she just says, no, thank you. And she's learned that when she adds thank you, it actually sounds so sweet when she says it. And it sounds really polite. So she just says, no, thank you. Like, can you help me with this? No, thank you. but it actually almost puts people in a different difficult position because then they have to ask you about why. So Nathalie, why aren't you having the corn? You know, that's they probably won't say that. They just taken aback a little bit. At least it puts people off one more step. Because you really shouldn't have to explain yourself.
No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You should not.
As long as you're not rude. I mean, in European culture, it's very similar, I would say, to your description of in Mexico. You do finish your food. You do not leave food. I mean, it's a very American thing to leave food on your plate. I have difficulties with it even now. So I do what Annmarie does. I take smaller portions versus leaving. But it's not always appropriate to have to finish. If you notice that you're not feeling good, then of course you shouldn't stuff it down. But I think it comes from those cultures where it's been war, it's been famine. I mean, you're supposed to finish what you've been given because otherwise it's rude. Especially when you go to someone's home. I mean, that's the problem with the holidays. You go to someone's home, someone has prepared the food, and they're taken aback when you don't like it. Yeah. So maybe one more solution to this conversation is to actually prepare the host. You know, if you're going somewhere and they don't know you, you can say, you know, just so you know, I don't really eat corn. I don't eat pasta. I don't eat these kind of things, just so they don't get disappointed and surprised.
Mm-hmm. So I love that you prepare the host. I never thought to do that for one. And sorry, my dog was going out of its mind. So I muted myself. But another thing is I always make sure if I'm going somewhere where I know that I don't really know the host, and I don't really know what's going to be served, I always bring something. And it's not that I just eat my food. That's not it at all. But I make sure it's something that I can eat and that it's not going to bother me. And it's going to complement the meal on a whole. And if you put a little bit of the other food on there, no one notices. And it is a very natural way to do, because you want to bring something with you. But while the dog was barking, all I could picture now is me in a very leave type voice saying to everyone this week, no, thank you. No, thank you. Because alcohol is another aspect of it.
Yeah.
I don't drink. I can't drink. Not just because of my medication. I have problems with my liver. It doesn't help my digestive system. And that can be a problem sometimes. It's always odd to me that people are like trying to shove a drink down my throat. Like, if I don't want to drink, why are you making me drink? And if I say no is no. Like, I don't need to have this. And especially when you have a chronic illness, you know, anything with your digestive system, diabetes, I don't know. I mean, it kind of, alcohol can affect it. Sometimes I'll bring like a fun little mocktail with me to share with everyone. And it goes over quite well.
Yeah. No, that's actually a really great point you brought up. I mean, I myself, I'm underage, but you know, like at college, like, yeah. So that definitely comes up a lot. And, you know, people ask questions and I'm like, oh no, like, you know, well, first of all, like illegal, but second of all, like I couldn't, like, even if I wanted to, because every time like I eat or drink something that I know will upset like my digestive system, I'm like, I put myself at risk, and like, I put my health at risk, and not just that, but I put myself at risk of, you know, going into a flare up. And sometimes it's difficult for people to understand that because they just don't get it. And then they'll be like, oh, but why? Like, you know, and then it's just so awkward again. And then most of the time I'll just be like, it's just like, I just don't want to, or something like that. And then people take that so positively because, you know, you're right, Karin, like what you say earlier, no one really wants to pry more once you just say no. And if you say no again, like, you know, people, I think, usually get like the memo and will just stop.
Yeah. I think so. Less is more sometimes, because when you start getting into excuses, I see a comment here from Rachel, and it's good. You know, I have a special diet, or I'm a picky eater. But by doing that, you're already putting yourself in a corner. You know, I do have a special diet. Then they're going to say, oh, what's that diet? What's that about? And then you have to say, then you start saying, I have ulcerative colitis and I have IBS. And then they're totally uninterested, or they're very interested and they have an opinion on it. And they say, well, but people with ulcerative colitis should be able to eat this.
That happens
really
to me.
Annoying.
Yeah, that's definitely happened, where I get the like typical like, oh, you know, oh, because that's another thing too. Is like, it's difficult for me to be like, oh, I have IBS and I have, and so instead of saying IBD now, I usually say Crohn's, because people think that IBS and IBD are the same thing. So when I say things like, oh, I have IBS and IBD, like I can't like eat that, then people get really confused. And then they ask more questions like that. So usually by like, just like saying like, you know, like, I just have like a chronic condition, or like, you know, just like, oh, like I'm not feeling well right now, honestly, things like that. Or even just like, yeah, like, cause I just kind of like, you know, you avoid like carefully, like you're kind of like going around their question. So you're like answering it without like really answering
really
it.
And getting I feel like
that's
into
the, it. Yeah. That's the most clever way to just work around those all.
Yeah. But you know, look at all this time. We spent 23 minutes talking about questions around diet. So it's obviously a big, big issue. And I think the bigger question for us is, and it's kind of triggered by this, is that because we're thinking so much about how to solve this problem with the food and feeling already, I'm already stressed about it. Like I'm already anticipating this conversation and the stress and, you know, what are people going to think? That takes away some of the joy of the actual holiday, which is not just about food, right? Holiday is also about getting together with your friends, your family, you know, relaxing. But if your mind is constantly busy by coming up with stories and worrying about this diet moment or the moment of the food, you know, you're not enjoying it in the same way. And some people will just avoid it altogether. I mean, I know people just say, no, I'm not going to celebrate with family because that is too hard. I've walked out of, you know, dinners because of this. And it's just that's not healthy either. So I wish we didn't have to think about it. I wish we could all just be respected for what, you know, how we choose to live and how we choose to eat. And that people don't have so many opinions. I mean, who cares? Everyone should be living the way they want to live. But I do think that the component of being a hostess or a host is just a sensitive one because they have put in all that work. And that's why, again, I think the preparation is so important. If you say, you know, I'm really so grateful for being invited to your home. I know you're a great cook and I really would love to enjoy it with you, but these are the things I can't eat. So don't be offended.
I love that. I think that is so brilliant. I've never in my life thought of that. I think it is so smart. I was a vegetarian for a long time and it used to stress me out because I didn't know what people were cooking. And I didn't want to say like, what are you cooking so that I can eat? That was always awkward. But if I would,
it is awkward.
Yes. And I didn't want to offend anybody. I don't want to go there and not eat anything because they cooked it with, you know, beef or whatever.
Yeah.
That's why I would bring something. But if I prepped it in a way that you just said, Karin, it would have been so copacetic. Everything would have been okay. Nobody would have been offended. It would have been great. I just never thought of it like that. It's funny how the little things trigger in your head. One thing that I want to add to this before we sign off is having a holiday buddy is something that I learned. And my cousins are my holiday buddies, different ones for different reasons. And sometimes all it takes is a look or a scratch on my head or I'm doing something and they'll pull me away from a conversation or they'll say, hey, I need some help over here. Or they'll come outside with me to get a breather or we'll take a bathroom break. Having a family friend or a family member at the event can really help you mentally prepare for dealing with things that make you uncomfortable.
Yeah, that's a really wonderful idea. I'm not particularly close with like my extended family, but something else I feel like should be normalized is like Thanksgiving can be more intimate and just with like your immediate family. It doesn't have to be like a really large gathering. Like I have anxiety, so like large gatherings in general are already like really stressful for me. So, you know, I really hope that like I would like that to get more normalized, is that it can just be you and your parents, if that's totally okay, like when you're feeling like sick, and you can just have just as much fun as if you were like, or maybe even more so, because like you can be in your pajamas and you know you're not like under the stress of like being around family members that you really only speak to like once a year, or maybe not even at all. They just kind of show up. So I think that's a really nice idea with the family buddy.
Well, that is a beautiful idea too. Just small, intimate little gathering. And I thank you so much for being an ambassador and being part of our beautiful community that is growing and thriving. We cannot wait for the future. Your future coming in and being part of our community and what we have coming up next. Right, Karin?
Absolutely. And we hope, Nathalie, that you will be one of our first members of IBD Life, which is launching for our intimate community already next week and for the larger community publicly in January. And IBD Life is a platform, a digital platform, where individuals affected by or affected with IBD, meaning Crohn's, colitis, but also IBS, can discuss, connect, support each other in a forum through one-on-one connections, find resources, and also do tracking of your health. And we will be adding many more features to IBD Life as we build, but we're super excited about this launching next week. And we hope that you can connect with someone that that you can share your experiences with and you can learn from. So welcome to that. It's ibdlife.com and it will be launching next week on the 1st.
I think Nathalie lost her internet, which is fine because we're just about over. And I just thought about something, Karin, that is so smart. The health tracker will be perfect during the holidays for people with IBD, IBS, and all that in between, because they can actually see what the eating and the holidays have done to them and adjust going forward.
Yeah, so, absolutely. You can track your food intake and your stool.
Exactly. There'll be lots of talk about that. Well, everyone, from our beautiful Lyfebulb team to yours, we hope you have a beautiful holiday. Hope it's peaceful, and I hope you eat the right things. So thank you for joining us today.
Happy Thanksgiving.